able to see my screen?
Yeah.
Yes, now.
Okay, fine. Yeah, fine, fine. So in today's session, basically, okay, my voice only is getting echoed.
And your screen is shaking, I guess, sir. Is it right?
Hello. Able to hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No echo.
Okay, fine. Okay, in this session, I'll be covering what is MDMS, how it works, and then how can we configure a new tenant and how to add state level and then ULB level data. Okay. So MDMS stands for Master Data Management System. So it is a core service in our Digit platform. Okay, it provides a basic functionalities like create, update, and fetch of master data related to different modules. Okay, these functionalities are exposed through REST endpoints. Okay. So basically how it works is it reads the data from the JSON files from a specific location. So this JSON data, the tenant ID will be served as a key and the data will be stored in a map. So I'll take UAT Uttarakhand application as a reference to explain. See, for example, the city drop down again. This is a MDMS data. So I will log in as a root key. Add credentials. Okay, so I'll use trade license or property tax module. For example, if we take trade license, see all this fields, financial year, application type, license type, structure type, subtype. So all these are like the values for these drop down are read from the MDMS. So this holds all the MDMS data. Occupancy type. So all these are read from MDMS. So once we submit, all this MDMS data will be as a part of request, it will be sent. And in the back end, we have a separate MDMS service which validates all this data sent against the MDMS data. Okay. So where this MDMS data kept? It is in the Git repository. So basically we have a different repo for each state level. So either we can have a single repo and multiple branches against each state, or a separate repo for each state, okay? But here we are using a separate repositories for state-wise. So for example, you can see for Punjab, we have separate Punjab MDMS data. For Bihar, Bihar MDMS data. For Uttarakhand, UKD MDMS data. So separate repositories for each individual states. So this is the folder structure, the UKD MDMS data inside the data folder. UK, and inside UK folder we'll have all the MDMS data, each module wise, state wise, and the ULB level, and which are common across all ULBs. So all the MDMS data will be kept inside this UK folder.
Malti, when we are doing the customization, we will be using the Playground MDMS data repository, or we will be like forking from any other UKD MDMS data
No. You'll be using the playground only, since we have the proper data in this environment. So I'm using this for reference. But for customizations and all, you'll be referring using the playground itself.
Okay.
So when this data will be populated in the database, which phase?
No, this MDMS data, it will be kept in Git. It won't go into, it is not read from the DB.
Okay. It's part of the application itself.
So while loading the application, there is a MDMS service. It is a core service. Okay, it will fetch all the required data, master data to be populated from this repositories. Okay, we have a different endpoints like create, search, and then update endpoint. So we'll use those endpoints, we'll use the fetch endpoint to fetch the data from this repository in our application. Okay,
so this will work as a core service and it will provide the JSON data as a...
Okay. That's what I showed here. So all this data will come from that this repo, Git repo.
So when you are saying the financial year, means it's right now you are showing that one list. So when we are updating, when we are going to the 2021, in that case, or 2021-22. So again, we'll be modifying the JSON file, or we'll be pushing it to some data, because every year it will be like incrementing the values. So it's automatically, we have to modify the JSON.
And then it won't work automatically. You need to add the JSON for that. So currently JSON it is, we have 2021. If you want to add 2022-23, you need to make changes in that JSON and it will reflect here.
Okay.
Either using the endpoint, you can push the data, or directly changing in the Git.
Okay.
See, the MDMS data is of two types. One is state level data and then ULB level data.
One question was, if you push it to the Git, whether it will be dynamically changing, I mean, whether you're reading this as one-time data or you read it at every instance?
No, it is a one-time data. When you load the application, it will be cached. Yes. Okay.
So if I change my year to 21-22 right now, then I have to restart the application then, right?
Yeah, since it is MDM, all the functionalities happens through API and it is a service, you need to restart your service to get the data changed, replicated, reflected.
Mandy, one thing, like when we are saying this deployment, so when we are creating the jar for MDMS, obviously it will get copied the JSON file in that jar and it will get deployed, right? So it lively doing this link every time. When we are pointing to MDMS, it's indirectly pointing to GitHub link, right? It won't happen in that way. Or it will be part of the application, MDMS application, right?
It's part of the application. I didn't get your question clearly.
The point is, when I do this MDMS service hit, using the REST service, if I make the call, the JSON file will be there inside that jar, right? It won't be calling the GitHub repository data to get the JSON.
Yes. It will be there. In the first level itself, all the data will be loaded and the service will hit that data. So each time it will not keep hitting the Git repo.
Okay.
Other point was, first instance of the service start, will it hit the repo?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the data, whatever the MDMS data, it is of two types. One is state level data and then the ULB level data. Okay. So the state level data, meaning it will have the data which is same across all ULBs. Okay. And then the ULB level, it will hold the data which is specific only to that ULB.
Okay. And what is the difference between ULB and district, actually? Or does it... only for
state
user.
Is nothing. ULB is nothing but cities. For example, Uttarakhand is a state. So inside Uttarakhand, we have Dehradun, Roorkee, Rudrapur. All these are like individual ULBs.
Okay. Yeah. In the case of documentation, it was mentioned like for cities, we will be making a different JSON, means one JSON node, and for ULB and district, we'll be making two things. So does it make any difference between ULB and city or district? It's more or less
you're
same
talking only. About boundary data.
Yeah,
I'll come to that point.
Okay,
that portion. Okay, so that is separate MDMS data.
Okay.
Okay, that boundary is itself is a separate ULB specific data. Okay, that I'll come to that point later. So, for example, you can see like trade license, property tax. So currently in UK we have two modules, trade license and property tax. Okay, so here under trade license we have these many master data. So basically the structure of the MDMS data would be in the JSON format, the file ending with .json, and then the inside the structure would be like it will be having tenant ID, it is a unique key, and then a module name, and then the master name. Okay, this is the structure of each MDMS file. So module name in the sense whether it is to which module it belongs to, property tax, trade license, or a billing service. So this master name is nothing but which master data, name of the master. For example, like application type or a financial year, so on so. Okay, inside it is a following is an array of values. So this is the basic structure of the MDMS file. Okay, so here UK we have two modules. So under each module we are keeping the data which are same across all ULBs. So this application type, like whether it is a new application or a renewable application, then occupancy type, trade types, these won't change ULB to ULB, city to city. Okay, so such data we are keeping under this module under UK.
What is the full form of ULB?
Local urban local body.
Okay, okay. Thank okay. you.
Okay, so then to see the trade license data which is specific to that ULB itself. So for example, I'll take Almora ULB. So here we have eGov location and a boundary data. That means this is specific to that ULB. So each ULB will have their own boundaries and the boundary data. So these data we are keeping under each ULB. Okay. For example, I'll take Dehradun. So here inside Dehradun, we have enabled two modules, trade license and property tax. Okay. The data which is specific to Dehradun and only for that module, trade license module, that goes under that tenant and then the trade license module and then the that particular file. Okay. So whichever specific to property tax and only to that ULB, we will be keeping under property tax, like interest, rebate, fire cess. These are all specific to ULB. ULB to ULB, these values will change. So such data we are keeping under that particular tenant and that particular module name. And this eGov location is outside these two folders. That means this data is same for all the modules. Okay, this won't change module to module. So this eGov location is nothing but it is the location details, that jurisdiction details. The list of mohallas for that ULB will be present in this file, boundary data. So here we have the hierarchy, a city, ward, and then mohalla. So that hierarchy is defined here. Okay, so city, Dehradun is a city. Inside that city there will be number of zones, like zone 1, zone 2, zone 3. So each zone will have a number of wards. Okay, ward 1. So again inside ward there will be mohallas, different mohallas. So this is a parent-child relationship. So this is what you were asking, I guess.
Yeah. In case if I add something new, so like what and all are mandatory field in this? Because I was checking the MDMS, in that one data is there, one PB was there, and the way we are writing for bound, we are writing the boundary detail in data default one, and the PB was not matching. So what and all things are mandatory, which we have to push it, we have to write it, or how this optional parameter are coming in a picture, like something, for example, code block is there, right, in this?
A block is not there. It it changes, the boundary hierarchy changes from state to state. For UK, we have till Mohalla, like city, zone, ward, and then Mohalla. So the block, I think, comes later part of it.
Okay. For example, helpline number is there. In Punjab data, it was there, and in default, it's not there. So like this, what and all keys are there and which we can use it. So do we have that detail? Or
tenant level detail, I'll explain you. Okay, that helpline and all is tenant specific details. Okay, I'll come to that.
Okay,
so these are all like module and state specific. Okay, I'll start with enabling a new tenant. So what all the data, mandatory data required to enable a new tenant, and how can we configure the module wise MDMS data for that tenant, I will explain. So then I think that will be better. Okay, so for example, now we have UK. Now I want to add one new tenant. New tenant in the sense, new ULB, say XYZ. So there are, in each MDMS file, MDMS repo, there will be mandatory folders. So those mandatory folders will be this roles, action control roles, role actions, and action test. Okay, so this I think I'll be taking at 4. About these files, and then following with city module.json and tenant json. These are the mandatory folders inside this MDMS repo.
Okay.
So tenant, these has many ULBs, so it is confusing. So I'll take Bihar. Explain. So this has some 7-8 ULBs enabled. This is fine. Okay. So here you can see we have this tenant, okay, and then common masters. So in each MDMS repository, there will be some 6 folders mandatorily. These first 3 folders, roles, role action, and action test, and then the common masters, and then this tenant file. So if you click on tenant, there are 3 files, citymodule.json, and then tenants.json. Okay, so this tenants.json, this hold all the ULB details. Okay. See, you can see, so each tenant wise we are providing the details. So this is for Bihar Sharif. Okay, so this is one tenant details. So it will have all the like logo ID, its domain URL, its city, the type of the city, and then the office timings, and then its grade, latitude, longitude, and the complete municipality name, address, contact number, and then the helpline, whatever the data is related to each ULB. So that will be added here inside the tenant.json. Okay. So if you're adding a new tenant, entry should be mandatorily made in this tenants.json file. So, and this code is unique. So the structure would be that BH which is nothing but the tenant ID dot the name of the ULB. So you should be very careful about this code, because we will be using this code everywhere, okay, to refer this tenant. See, and this is for Muzaffarpur. So like this, the tenant details will be added here. So other than any additional data except whatever shown here, if you have, you can add a key value pair, okay, and you can use this key in your application to show up that value. So here we have only contact number. If any helpline number you want to newly add for that tenant, so add one more key saying helpline number, then that value, and you should use that key in your application.
Okay, so in this only, like, we are having the district code, okay, in city level, so which is 209, I think. I'm not able to see it clearly. So where is this entry of this district code and district name? Or
so this values we will not be providing, the state team will provide. These are all the ULB data. Okay, they will share all the details, district code, district name. So these are all mandatory fields which they will share. Whichever they don't share, we either put the default value or it will be a empty value.
Okay, so in our database, we don't have the district related data, but when we are making the entry, some transaction related entry, we will be making this district code 209, and the state party will understand this, something like that. I mean, how this district code will get used?
See, this is like a unique identifier to refer this particular tenant. Okay. So in our application, we use this code, BH.BiharSharif. Okay. And this district code, it is unique, which is a unique code provided by the state. Okay. And this will be used in our reports to show the value. Nowhere in the transaction this will be considered. So this will be, this code will be used actually.
Okay.
Okay. So this is not a transactional referred data. So this is the city level data, like in reports and all, and then in our receipts, when you make a payment, receipts and all, if you want to show some info about each ULB, and those information will be read from this. Okay.
Okay.
And then this district code, in some places we use it to generate a unique ID, like application ID. So in some state, there was a request, like whatever the application number we generate for trade license, it should hold the financial year and ULB code. Okay. To say this application belongs to this ULB. In that case, that ULB code is nothing but this code.
Okay.
We will use that code.
And what is the reason name and ULB grade as such? In this only, in below that district name only, ULB grade and reason name is also there in there.
So ULB grade in the sense, there will be municipal corporation, then there are different types of municipalities.
So again, municipal... this is a fixed category for this, or we can write anything in that? This ULB grade as a value of ULB grade.
This again will be shared from the state.
Okay.
For example, a few cities will be like Sonpur Municipal Corporation. Few will be like Sonpur Municipality, just municipality. So in that case, that is the ULB grade.
The question would be, how are you using this ULB grade in your application?
Once again. See here, if you see Roorkee Municipal Corporation, this is the ULB grade. Okay, and this is the ULB name.
Okay.
So it won't be like there will be a different grades. Okay, so it won't be same for all the ULBs. So this will be read from the tenant JSON file.
Okay.
So the basic information, mandatory information of the tenants, or if you want to add a new tenant, one entry should be mandatorily there in this tenant.json with the compulsory keys for code, district code, and then the this tenant code, and then grade. So this address, contact number, email ID, these are all optional. Okay, so we can assign it null. And the logo, this is the ULB logo. So this logo ID will hold the path of that logo. For example, this logo. So this, whatever this picture, it comes from this path, whatever, whichever we have mentioned here.
Same with the reason code also will be given by the state authority, right?
Yes.
Reason code. Okay. And code and CAPTCHA is what? CAPTCHA means in this only. So it's like enabling the CAPTCHA for registration purpose or what?
Currently, as of now, it is not shared. So right now, I'm not aware, but we are not using this.
Okay.
Okay. Maybe this save file location and all, like in case of GIS, if you want to enable. Okay. So for example, in PGR application, we have a GIS location mapping functionality where to raise the complaint, actual location. Okay. So in that case, some shape files will be shared here. That location will be shared here. And this CAPTCHA might be for that purpose, which you mentioned. But currently, as of now, these are not used. Okay, but the provisions are there.
Okay.
So we added one tenant. So then for that tenant, which all modules we need to enable? So that mapping, we will add it in citymodule.json. So this file holds the mapping between the ULB and the modules. Like for each ULB, what all modules are enabled. For example, see, this is the structure of this file. MDMS file, the mandatory keys would be tenant ID, module name, and then the master name. This master name is city module, okay? And this module name stands for that, this under BH, this folder name, okay? City module, so here we are mentioning that the module TL, TL stands for trade license. This trade license module should be enabled for this number of cities. See, so trade license should be enabled for these many tenants. See, again here we are referencing to this tenant using the code, and whatever the code you mention here should be same as the code which is mentioned in the tenant.json file. Okay.
So if same. Some module is applicable for all, in that case, we can keep it blank or we have to write each and every entry? Means the TL is applicable for all the ULBs. In that case, do we need to make entry for each and every ULB or keep it blank?
No, no, no. You need to make an entry in this.
Okay.
Okay. Whichever ULBs you want to enable TL, that ULB should be present here. Okay. So, and this code should be same as the code which is added in the tenant.json. If there is one, and this is case sensitive. If any small change or some syntax error or some spelling mistake, so it will not be enabled. So similar way, module UC is nothing but universal collection. Again, for this module is enabled in these many ULBs, so and so, okay. You can see some four modules are mapped for few tenants. So creating a tenant using tenant.json, enabling applications for that tenant will be done in the citymodule.json.
in city module, right? Whatever the code we have mentioned, like TL or PGR or apply, so these are again fixed value. Where we are defining this means this module name should be mentioned like this only.
Okay, that is in some config file, which is in the beginning of the data. Okay, these two are clear, right? Tenant's JSON and city module. And then there is one more mandatory folder called common masters. So inside this common master, this stateinfo.json is a mandatory file. Okay, for that module wise naming convention, that keeping TL and PT, I'll come to that point later.
Okay.
So on this file common master stateinfo.json, this state info itself mentions state information. For example, the images that gets populated on load of the application, the background image. For example, I'll log out. See the background banner image. And all this, and this Nagar Seva, Uttarakhand, all these are like image files. Okay, and this we will mention the path of that images, banner URL, the logo URL, let's see, Buddha.jpg. So, whatever the state specific informations that we will mention it here, and the navigation URL. And this language specific is related to localization. Again, that session is there tomorrow. I'll explain on that. So basically, all the state information related to the landing page images, the banner URLs, all those are kept here. And then citizen navigation URL, employee navigation URL, that is kept here, and what is the default language. So all these information will be part of this, and the user manuals will be kept under stateinfo.json. Okay, and then now after adding a tenant, enabling modules. So for each module, the basic, there will be some set of master data. Okay, so where it is defined, and then how it will be loaded. So that portion I will explain now. So now
actually where we are defining this logo file and all, so it should be some specific dimension, or do we have to directly copy in the file store, or do we have an option of uploading it through some application?
To upload it, that file store location you need to mention.
Okay,
and the dimensions and all will be like here it is a file store S3 location,
right?
Okay, and it will have some set of properties, width, height and all. based on the banner image, there will be a different set of properties, and then for logo it will be a different set of property. So that is image property actually.
Right.
Okay.
So we expecting it in some particular size or that. So that's what.
Yeah. See, for the banner URL, the size would be different, and after login, the logo size will be different. So if you want the property of that images, I can share from the file store. Okay, but nowhere it is kept like it should be of only this much size.
Okay.
So where exactly the REST services are getting exposed?
Means?
This JSON will be accessed through REST service, right?
There is a MDMS service.
Where is that? Can you just show that, please?
Yeah.
Part of core service.
Yeah. Okay. See. So this is the service.
And in starting, you were saying also that like using the REST service also, we can update the configuration. So in that case, where it will get persisted?
So actually, fetching we do through the endpoint. There is a facility to do create and update, but we are not entertaining that. Because since it is a master data, directly allowing pushing data into the Git, it is not provided. What we have done is we have added a PR, like a pull request, this thing. On upon approval only, it will get merged here, whatever MDMS data changes we make. So currently, we will be using the fetch endpoint to retrieve the MDMS data. So this, after showing up how to add the MDMS data for each tenant and ULB, I'll come to this REST endpoints. Or you want me to explain now this and then show that? Later?
No. You go by the flow only, right?
So this is the service. You got it right?
Yeah, fine. Okay. Yeah, got it.
Where is that? Okay. Okay. So again, this city list, you can see, this comes from the tenants.json. Whatever the city is loaded there, that will be listed here. Okay, since UK, we have around some 60, 40 plus ULBs, those many are shown up here. So inside common master, state info is fine. And then see, this common masters holds the data which is same across all modules and all ULBs. Okay. It is common to the state, like department, designation. This will not change from module to module. So it remains same. So such common data will be kept under common masters. Fine. So there are three levels of data. So one is which is common irrespective of module and irrespective of tenants. Okay, that is nothing but state level data. The second thing is it is common for all ULBs, but it is module specific. Okay, that means like there will be a trade license is a module, so there will be some set of values which will be same for all ULBs, which will not change from ULB to ULB. That is the second level of data. The third level would be, for the same module, there will be a different set of data for each ULB. Okay. So the first set would be this common data, which is same across state, irrespective of modules and ULBs. So such data will be kept under common masters. So the second level data would be module specific, and it is same across all ULBs. So that will go under that module name, trade license. So for trade license, the application type remains same for each ULB. There will be only two types, new and renewal. So in every ULBs, it will be same types only. It won't differ. So such data, it will come under that module specific, module name. The application type, we have market type, and again inside that master data, the keys and values, it will not be like same for all files. It depends on the value data we get from the state. For example, few master data will have some five set of values: code, name, active, and then some more description, so on so. Okay, so few will have only code active. So it depends on the data we get.
So that's not fixed. Like in this, we are using two only. In some places, we will be using four and five. So what in all option we have as a key, or we before asking the client, we should be knowing like these five things we as a default it's configurable, and then remaining part will come in the customization of application. We will be doing that.
So see, the maintaining a key is up to you at each master level. So sometimes they will say they will give only two things, saying see, for example, I'll take application type. So they said we have only two types, new and renewal. They will not know that we need something specifically. Okay, so if this share some same repeated data with some minor changes, it is up to us to maintain the code. Okay, so we can add one more key saying which is unique, and give our own values. See, here we have code and active, application type dot new. For this, actual value will be pushed using localization. Okay, to show the actual value, this is the code we are using. And you said some places it is some 3-4, right? I'll show such values also. Let me see. Type.json. See, it has more number of properties. See here, it has code, UOM, application document, and then again some set of values. So again, it depends master to master.
If I ask you in this, like code is market.cs.t075. What does it convey? Means it's a kind. It's a part of some flow, or it's a means.
Actually, for Bihar, trade category. They will share only the. We have this hierarchy: trade type and trade subtype, category type and subtype. Okay.
Okay.
And they will share all those values. So instead of keeping three MDMS data. Okay, all those will be combined here. This market is nothing but it is the trade type. Trade type is market. We have only one type. Okay, inside that market, CH is a this is the category, this is the type, and this is the subtype code for it. It has three levels of hierarchy, this code. This is subtype, type, and the category. Okay.
So we can go three levels. Yeah, we can go three levels down. Tomorrow, if we need to go four levels down, should one more dot work? Will it work? Has it been done in that way?
Yeah. Yeah, it will work, but in the UI, how you show up, you need to take care. Okay, for example, here I'll show you that application. See, the trade unit has category, type, and subtype. Trade category, it is fixed. Okay, trade only. I'm showing Bihar MDMS data and matching up with UK. Better I show UK only. Roorkee. See, so here trade hotel and TR01. So trade type is hotel and trade subtype is hotel lot gets our 11 to 15 bed. So here there is a code we define. So when the state will share this data, we are defining code for this combination. Okay, so trade dot the trade type code would be hotel, and for this some code, so that code mapping will be done here. Trade hotel 0102 some unique code.
It will be cross product, so almost.
If you want to add one more level of hierarchy, means again on choose of this, some other child drop down gets loaded. You will be adding here dot something, and in your UI you should handle the logic to load that data.
So right now we are supporting maximum 3 level, right? I mean, by default it will take care, right? This UI part.
Yes. Now okay. Up to 3 level it is handled.
Okay. When we say the TR01, okay, and TR01 is mapped with some value. So that mapping is where it's done. That is again, that will be in database, or that will be again in JSON only?
No, that is in database. That is nothing but a localization. This is the code. For each code, there will be a readable value like hotel up to 50 bed. So that data will be read from the DB.
Okay.
So that again is a localization data. For example, if we choose Hindi, this value should show up in Hindi, right?
Right.
But the key remains the same. Okay, the key will not change. So this is an data which is read from the DB, and it is part of localization. That I'll explain. There is a separate session for localization. Okay.
And I'll explain it will be stored in Postgres only, right? And not as JSON like this.
No. Not as JSON. It is in the proper table only, normal text.
Okay.
Yeah, the way I understand it, you are storing then TR01, you have n number of language columns.
The value will be pushed for the same code. For example, now if we are supporting English Hindi, for this code, I'll be having two values, English value and Hindi value.
I think for TR01, you'll have those two values. For hotel, you'll have other two values.
Yes.
Malti, one question, like when we are saying this code, trade is representing this trade unit particular option. So do we have something like that, or we have to debug like, okay, this trade is representing the trade unit in this form, something like we only have to debug and check. Means you can understand this part, that trade is one key, hotel is one key, and TR01 is one key. TR01 is, I can understand that, but trade is defining the trade unit. Okay, like this, some other key is defining this particular option in UI. Do we have that mapping, or we have to debug?
No, this is, we have given, there is no fixed mapping. This key is, we have given. So there is no, nothing specific. You can see here, UK, it is given as trade. In Bihar, it is given as market dot. Okay. So there is no specific naming conventions for code. So it is for our developer purpose. here you can see in UK they will say trade category as trade. In Bihar they are telling trade category as market. Okay, when we populate the value for inside Bihar trade license, it will not show up trade, it will show up market. Based on that, we have given. There is no specific convention that it should be of, for everything it should start with trade only.
Sorry, I asked the wrong reference. Actually, if I say the trade type, the key name is trade type before that. Okay. This is one key which is representing some UI element. Okay. For this thing, I'm saying like this is the UI element. This key is representing some UI element. That mapping we have, or we have to debug it. The trade type is representing that particular box which is having the trade space type.
Sorry, I did not get it clear.
The thing is, see, we are having the option of customizing this trade type and trade location like this. The two element I directly got with the name mapping. Okay, the trade type will be of trade type. So like this only.
You're telling if you want to add few more trades.
See, trade unit is there here. The name of the box.
Yes.
I think it's talking about the UI element.
Right. So this UI element is mapped with that trade unit. Trade. So that mapping we have, or we have to debug and see, okay, this element is represented by this key.
Okay. It is not like that. It is assumed that this trade category, this is a MDMS data that gets loaded from trade type.json.
Okay.
Okay. And then this loading part will be handled in the UI itself.
Okay.
Yeah. Is that is what you were asking, right?
Yeah, but somewhat understood. I was
Vipin, right, basically that is actually some key they are maintaining. The actual data comes from that localization, right? You can have any key there, and that has to be mapped there.
I got me that point. I got
there is no significant business logic written for it.
No. That category part I got it. I'm saying for the UI element. That this element trade unit represented by this key or trade location details will be represented by this key. Do we have that mapping?
What from this will bring up the UI?
Or with the name only?
Got it. You are telling whether this unit is mapped. With this particular MDMS
trade type. This is mapped by the trade type, right? This trade unit box or div is mapped by the trade type. So do we have that mapping?
This div itself is completely, this div is not mapped. Only this drop-downs data will be loaded through the this trade type.json.
Okay.
So if you see in the inspector, there will be a separate.
So we have to inspect and check the elements, right?
No, putting it other way around, if I don't have that JSON, what will happen?
It will show empty. It will not load.
But still the div will come up.
What will the?
But still the UI component will be showing. Only the values UI will not be there.
Yes. See, these datas are loading from the MDMS. This is a UI component. On load, it will get loaded. This text. These are all fixed, right? Trade type, trade category. These will be loaded. If there is no data in that, it will show empty. You mean like the entire trade
got
unit
it,
will
it,
not?
No. Got it. Sorry.
So this master has multiple values. Okay, for this combination, we are mapping some documents which are mandatory. Okay, for example, here on choose of this next step, there is one section called documents. So here, whatever the documents are mentioned here, that will be shown there. Okay, so such kind of master data. So some master datas have only two keys, and here the trade type has many. It depends on the master to master. Okay. So So it is not fixed, like each and every master will have some specific key value pairs. So again, we are mentioning whether this trait type is active or not. In some cases, if we want to disable, like ULB may say that these set of subtypes should be disabled, then if you, by marking it as false, it will not show up in the drop down. It is just to enable and disable in such cases. So these trait types are specific to Roorkee. So some other ULB will have some different set of trait types. So it will be defined in that specific ULB. Okay. And there is a configuration file. You can see in the starting, for example, I'll show here only MDMS data, MDMS masters config.json. So here we mention whether that particular master is a state level master or a ULB level master. For example, if I say trait type, see, is state level false. This means this master is a ULB specific master. Okay. And if we mark this as true, saying that it is a state level data, and if this file does not exist, so it will try to look in the trade license folder, not inside each ULB level folder. Okay. If we mark it as false, it assumes that it is a ULB level data, then it tries to find this trait type.json file in each ULB and then loads the data. This enabling and disabling, it is mentioned here. And which key to consider as a unique key, that is also we are keeping here only. For example, if there are multiple keys, for example, if trait type has many properties like application document, UOM, code, many others. So among those set, which one should be considered as a unique key, that we will mention it here. So we are saying consider code as a unique key for this master. Okay. And whether it is a state level or not, that configuration also kept here. So ULB specific data adding we saw, and then trade license, this holds all the module specific which are common to all ULBs will be kept under trade license, and specific to each ULB, it will go by that ULB folder. Inside that, module wise, we will place it. So if you want to add new master file for particular ULB and for particular module, so you'll be adding under that ULB for trade license. So you'll be adding a new JSON file, and that JSON file you need to mention in that config file. Okay, whenever you are adding a new master, so that master definition should be kept it under that MDMS data master config, saying what is the key of that master, whether it is a state level data or a master data. So that entry should be made here.
Why we need to specifically mention this? Means code part is okay, but why we need to mention each and every entry in this master config file? Based on that only it will read, or it will skip the remaining folders? It's master config file which we are saying.
See what happens, the unique keys might differ from one master to other master, right? So one will say code as a key, some others will have different as a key. So each entry should be made here. Otherwise, how will you distinguish whether it is a state level or a ULB level?
If it's coming under means ULB folder, then it says ULB specific. That's why.
In some cases, what happens is there will be a toggling. Bihar has everything at state level. Okay. So then UKD, sometimes they said a trade type is a state level. And then for few ULBs, they said then it should be kept as a ULB data. Okay. In such cases, having all the configurations in one file would be easier, right?
Okay.
And then saying this unique keys. So there will be a different key. See, for example, here, ID is used as a unique key. For some master code is used as a unique key. So instead of handling all these use cases in the coding part, so in one place as a config, if it is kept, it is easier for maintenance purpose.
Okay.
So here we have these many folders. See, please, in the tenant file, one more point. Outside this tenant, we have a list of ULB names, right? So this name and in the tenant, the name should match. Okay, here saying some other name, and then in the tenant file having some other name, it will not match up. It will give error. It will not load the data for it. So that is one more point to be noted. So that's it about MDMS data. So I'll come to the end point. And again here, as I said, we maintain different repositories state-wise. Okay, so within a state, like in UK, we have different environments, like dev environment, UAT environment, and production environment. Okay, so the MDMS data, what we will do, we will branch out and we will have our different branches. Like for UAT environment, UAT, dev environment, that specific dev. Whenever there is a release happens from like UAT to production, then we'll promote all the changes inside UAT to master. So now see, this is a production MDMS data. So as part of the development, we will keep adding on, making modifications to the data that will be there here. So during the release process, all the required data will be merged to the master branch. Okay. So on the different environments, we will be having a different branches. Either you can maintain a single branch for UAT and dev and separate for production. Anyways, which is...
What about those three folders, initial folders, access control?
This is control related to role action mapping. This is there between 4 to 5. Should I continue or after the break?
It's okay.
As I said, this MDMS service, we have endpoints to create, to update, and to fetch. Okay. So this is the... environment and the service name, and this is the endpoint. We can filter out based on the keys. For example, I'll take up in Uttarakhand UAT, we have a, I'll show up some data. We have EGF masters. Okay, so EGF is nothing but financials, EGO financials master. So here we have one file, financial year JSON. It is a master data. Okay, it has list of financial years. So now I want to weave this data. So what I'll be doing, using the endpoint. So here each endpoint will have a request info and then the criteria. Okay, here I need to pass the auth token. Then here I'll mention tenant ID, which tenant, UK, then the module details. Here the module details would be UK. Inside the module details, what is the module name? Module name would be EGF master. And what is the master detail? Which is the master you want to see? Financial year. The name should match of this folder. Okay, so here it is listing all the financial year data. Okay, fetch endpoint. So currently update and create. See here for update again, what is the data we need to add up? Those details we will provide. Currently this is not enabled, update and create. So we usually do it through Git only.
That seems to be a better approach, right? Because you also have this who has done it and all.
PR approval. That is because better. This may lead, enabling the endpoints may lead to some error data. So hence, we are not entertaining through endpoints, create and update. So fetch is fine. And through Git, with PR approval, we will merge the changes. Any doubts?
Where can we get these URLs?
Hmm?
Where can we get these URLs for hitting this master data?
The Postman URLs?
Yeah.
If you want, I can share the collections. Otherwise, through the service path, you can get it, right? Okay. The environment and MDMS service, we even search. Okay. So we have a service, code service.
Yeah, reach up to the core service and MDMS service.
MDMS in that controller will have all the endpoint details.
Okay. With that, okay. We have to.
V1 underscore search. Again, we have get reload. This here you can find out. From here, you can get this one will be your environment, which environment you are going to access.
One more thing, multi that tenant.json, right? In that we can add a new tenant. Suppose I have a more than one keys, like whatever the current tenant.json is there, I want to add some more key value pairs, so I can add it into that using my new key value pair. So do I need to keep all these existing ones? Suppose I do not want to maintain some of these key value pairs. So do I need to maintain all these things, or can I remove whichever I do not want other than the code?
Except the mandatory ones, all others you can take off.
Okay, which one are the ones?
Since the ULB is given, and in UK what happened is, like in the reports, whenever we make a collection and generate a receipt, as part of the receipt header, they were asking for this address, contact number, and then some email ID. So those details we kept here. But this office timings, which all description, all these are not required. Twitter URL, Facebook URL, these are all not needed. These we are not using anywhere. These can be taken out. This longitude, latitude is required in case of GIS, PGR application. So these are all required. Region code, this municipality name, ULB grade. So these things are required. And these additional things like office timings, email ID, Facebook, Twitter URL, these are all not needed.
Okay.
These are all added as part of whenever they came up saying we wanted to show some info on receipt or some PDF, it's been added as part of that. It is not fixed, like all this should be mandatorily there.
Okay. And one more thing, MDMS master configuration. Okay, in that we are telling like we have to specify each state level is true or not. Like if the data is available for all the state, we have to specify it as true. Yeah, if it is not available, means if it is not specific to the state, so do we need to make it as false, or we can remove that key itself? Because in some of this key value base, that each state level is not present.
Okay.
Now, for example,
then like by defaultly it will take it as state level.
Okay, so default it will be state level true.
See, population does not have that.
Each state level true. Yes.
By default, it will consider as state level only. And this unique keys, it need not be always one. It can be combination in number of keys.
Okay.
So there will be some Confluence link on the service endpoints and all. I will share post to this if required. Anything else, like any other one?
Malti, actually in code you were showing, right? So the endpoint was V1 something. Postman call. So it's like you are managing a different version using V1, V2 like that for congestion purpose?
Yes. Currently, core service, it will not change very frequently. Okay. So, but this is kept for versioning purpose. In future, if there is any changes as part of it.
Okay. And that auth token is there, right? So you are logging into service and then you are getting the token through browser only, or you are calling some different, hitting the different service to get the auth token as such?
There's a different service, either through endpoint only you can generate this auth token, or through application also. Through application, you need to log in and in the inspector take the token, or else here I'll show that endpoint generating an auth token. See, here we have, this is a service, user service. There's a provision to generate token. So I will do it for Uttarakhand. So in body, here's username is this, password is, see, this token you need to pass it. So there are two ways, either through application or through endpoint, using the service endpoint. So if it is through application, you just log in as that particular user, application, local storage. So it will show the token, this token. Okay.
Is there any authorization checks on that? Or just we can use that endpoints with this, anyone gets the token and does it, in the sense that authorization.
For that purpose only we are using this token, right?
That is authentication. I am talking about authorization. All users get to do this.
See, now only super user can do it. So if you pass only super user auth token only, it will work. Any other employee's token or any other user token, it will not work.
Okay.
So the user with which Malati is demonstrating, that's a super user.
Super user has
that access to update, get, fetch, and all those things.
So that will be it's part of the second session, which starts at 4 o'clock. Role action mapping. So far it's clear. Any doubts or?
This is clear.
Okay. Then again, we'll join back at 4. There is one more session on roles and role mapping. How can we add a new action and how to provide access for that action? So those details I will explain in the second session. Okay. Okay, we'll join back at 4.
Okay.
So any questions built in till now? So this is a pretty important area for any of the application which you deploy, okay? So because see, master data is something which will ultimately flow across applications. So this is something which you set up once. I mean, the trades and all are trade license specific, but then stuff like tenants and all these details, they are something which you set up once and they will kind of be reused across all the modules. So like Malti was saying, so there are some details which are printed on the receipts. There are email IDs and phone numbers. So just one thing wherever Malti is saying is ULBs, there in BL's case, it will be cantonments. Okay. So for example, if you want to have some cantonment specific details on the bills and receipts and stuff like that, so MDMS is where you will kind of configure them.
And it is only the JSON files which we modify, right? And nothing to be done with respect to the code service, right?
No.
Yeah.
It's just the, okay. So it's a clean break between data and code, right? So code is responsible to generate all your stuff, whereas data is something which will decide what gets shown over it. So the localization logic also Malti explained very well. So that is also something which you can keep in mind, because the cantonment boards being spread across various states. So if a localization requirement comes in, for example, if cantonments, especially in the southern part of state, request for maybe Tamil or Kannada or Kerala, or even in UP, they stress a lot on Hindi, UP, Bihar, Uttarakhand, those sides. So that is something. So how it is managed is really good. So what you get here is you get one code, and against that code, you can kind of map as many languages as you want. So it's not just restricted to one or two. You can map multiple languages, and then based on your selection, the system will render that value on UI.
Okay.
Omkar, tomorrow there is a detailed session on localization separately.
Okay.
So
okay,
how can we push and all in detail? I'll explain it tomorrow.
Cool. Okay. Theek hai. So if there are no questions, we'll reconvene at 4. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Great.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, guys. Okay. Thanks, Martin.
Omkar, on stop recording, it will be saved in my drive or?
It will be saved in Elson's drive, Malti.
Okay. I will stop the recording then.
Stop the recording.